Now, it's The Law Show on CL 650. A comprehensive look at everything you need to know about the law. Now, here's Sterling Fox.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
A little homegrown Christmas warmth there from Michael Bublé to start off this episode of The Law Show here on CIL 650. Good morning and welcome. Joe Murphy, QC, and Bill Dick are with us from Murphy Batista, personal injury lawyers in Vancouver. Gentlemen, welcome back. It's good to see you both.
Good morning, Sterling.
Good morning.
Tell us a little bit about the firm, Joe Murphy. Your name is on the shingle. You and Joe Batista founded it back in the 80s when it was a pretty dicey time to begin a business with interest rates over 20%. You're still around to tell the story.
Yes, Sterling. We set the firm up, Joe Batista and I and two secretaries, in January of 1982. I remember the time well because the interest rates were 20%.
Mm-hmm.
Businesses were closing everywhere. The economy across Canada, I think, in the States, was shuttering, and we ended up opening a business, which was new. We, as I say, began with two lawyers and two secretaries. We're now many years later. We have 17 lawyers. We have a support staff of about 60, and we have offices in Vancouver and in Kelowna. So things have changed.
They certainly have. And Bill Dick is with us from Kelowna. Bill, it's good to see you again. It's been several months. And last time you jumped in on the program, you were the lone lawyer in the Murphy Batista Kelowna Bureau. And now there are three of you.
That's right.
Business must be terrific up there.
Well, we were lucky enough to pilfer another lawyer from another firm who's fantastic, named Carrie Grenier. And we're quite busy, and things have been going very, very well.
It is party time, boys. It's December 13th, Christmas coming up in less than 2 weeks. All of those company parties, all of those house parties, and then, God forbid, New Year's looms large after we get through the Christmas round. So it's a very good time to have you two join us, as we're going to talk a lot about host liability and some of the rules governing party season, both for people and for companies. And let's start with companies, Joe Murphy, and let's start with you. You and your partner, Joe Batista, you're the proprietors of your company, and I'm betting pretty safely that you have some kind of Christmas staff function.
Oh, yes,
in which
definitely.
The odd drop of eggnog, et cetera, must be served.
Yes,
so
yes.
What liabilities are you and your partner, as the owners of the business, what liabilities do you incur by throwing that staff Christmas party?
Well, Sterling, our party involves dinner and a whole bunch of drinks for everybody. So we have about 80 people there. We have a wide open bar. We say to the staff, if you want to take a cab to the party and home, we will pay for that.
Yep.
We say to the staff, if you want to stay downtown in a hotel that night, we will pay for that. Because the last thing we want is for someone in the firm to get hurt that night, or even possibly worse, that they hurt someone else.
Right, right.
But the reality is that, in my mind, doesn't let us off the hook. We still have to be careful, because just traveling to and from the party isn't the only danger we have to worry about. We have to worry about people who are very drunk and sometimes do stupid things, foolish things. Drunks fall all of the time.
They do.
We know that people can suffer terrible injuries
yes.
from simply falling.
Mm-hmm.
So the parties are fun. Everybody has a great time. Many people have hangovers the next day,
uh-huh.
but we're aware that we've got to try and make it as safe as we can for everybody.
If somebody falls on the way to their car in the parking lot and bangs their head, and it turns out it's a pretty nasty shot, and they end up in the hospital and they're messed up a little bit, what liability, again, if any, falls on your shoulders for what may come out of that in terms of a lawsuit?
Well, Sterling, I think the fundamental responsibility for the person drinking is to not drink too much.
Okay.
You, the person drinking, knows better than anybody else how much you've had and how it's affecting you. But if the host of the party overserves, I believe that creates a potential liability if something bad happens from the overservice.
Okay. So that open bar, while a wonderful gesture of generosity on the part of the company, can sort of may come back and bite you, so to speak.
Yes. Yes.
But what, Bill, where does the individual's responsibility? I mean, of course the company is assumes some liability when they throw a staff function. Any size company, there are liabilities here. But what about the responsibility of the individual? As Joe just said, people show up at Christmas parties and misbehave terribly sometimes, just really lose it. So where does the individual's responsibility start and stop, Bill?
I mean, that's a really good question. And I think there is a huge onus ultimately on an individual who's an adult not to park their autonomy at the door when they come into a party. They still have that responsibility. And if they end up hurting themselves or hurting other people, the vast amount of responsibility is going to fall on that individual.
Okay.
And, you know, it's interesting in terms of what Joe just said, because over the course of time since I've been a lawyer, I've seen Christmas parties change.
Okay.
Where at the beginning, it was open bar, people were getting hammered
yep.
and having a great time. And then slowly, as the law evolved at the same time, and employers were being shown to be at fault and liable, the Christmas parties that I attended changed because the owners ultimately went, you know what? We have a responsibility here.
Right.
We could potentially get sued. So the bars became, you can have two tickets to drink.
Sure, yeah.
But I think as what Joe said, the employers were saying, we also have to make sure that people get home safe. We have a responsibility. We're going to make sure that people get into cabs and or have a place to stay at night.
Right.
And all of those sort of things. But ultimately, in any lawsuit where you end up having a liability question, the ultimate responsibility lies to the person who makes that decision to overconsume.
Let me describe another company-type Christmas staff party. And let me use my own company, New Cap Radio, here in Vancouver. We have a Christmas where we've been doing this for years under several different ownerships. We have the same formula. The staff is offered rooms at a downtown hotel. Most of them take that offer up, except for some of us who are just don't drink that much anymore. I can't keep up to them. I don't want to try. But most of the staff takes a room in a hotel, and then the company provides a bus, Joe, from the hotel to the actual party venue where copious quantities of booze and food are served, and lots of, you always have live music, great live music, and then the buses take the gang back down to the hotels and drop them off literally in the lobby. So is the company, legally speaking, doing a really, is this a really smart strategy? Because they've dropped them off in the lobby, they kept them off the streets of the city, and boom, everybody's safe and tucked away. Is that a completely sealed off legal responsibility scenario?
No, the responsibility doesn't end at getting a person to and from a hotel. The responsibility goes beyond that, because if someone is really drunk, they can get into trouble. They can hurt themselves
yeah.
or hurt others, even once they're transported back to the hotel lobby. It doesn't end.
Yeah, there is a case in British Columbia involving a fairly well-known, not-to-be-mentioned law firm in Vancouver, where they had a party, and one of the associates went to a bar later and fell on another person. And ultimately, the law firm and that person was found responsible. So it doesn't just end.
So the falling on another person caused some injury.
Yeah. That was on the dance floor.
On the dance floor at a bar.
Oh, my.
So it can extend.
Drunks on the dance floor.
Lawyers on the dance floor. That in and of itself.
Trouble.
Should be trouble. But the law is that an employer does have a duty to its employee
right.
because of the relationship between an employer and employee to make sure that they're safe. Whether it extends to a party afterwards is an interesting legal question, but I think at least in one case in Ontario, they did say you have a positive obligation to make sure that people are safe. If you have a social function,
well, that's exactly where I was going to go with this one next, because we've already opened the topic of responsibilities and liabilities associated with hosting parties and seasonal events at this time of year. There's no shortage of them, but I've been talking about it so far from a corporate or business perspective. The company throws the event or invites the staff to someone. Let's move the conversation to your house when you have the neighbors over for eggnogs and Christmas cake, or the family gathers, or it's just a casual social event, no corporate involvement whatsoever. Where do the responsibilities and or liabilities rest in that case? Bill, let's start with you.
Sure, yeah. If you are the host of a party, you're considered in law to be a social host in Canada. And so far, the courts have not held a social host liable. If someone gets intoxicated and leaves your house,
right,
you have a duty as an occupier to make sure that people are reasonably safe in your house.
Right, sure.
But if someone leaves, the leading case, there's a Supreme Court of Canada decision where someone went to someone's home, got in 2 hours, drank 12 beer.
Uh-huh.
The host didn't know how much they had. This guy's known to be a heavy drinker, and he left. This is in Ontario. He crossed the center line and he struck another vehicle, rendering one girl paraplegic, quadriplegic.
Man.
And it went up to the Supreme Court of Canada, and they looked at what are the duties of a social host.
And the case went to the Supreme Court.
Court of Canada.
First of all, because the girl who was injured in the car accident sued the guy who was drunk and driving. Was it her lawyer that tried to get the host of the party involved in the lawsuit? How to make the connection?
Sure. Yeah, the girl who was ultimately hurt and rendered a quadriplegic sued the driver who ultimately had no insurance.
Oh, for crying out loud. On top of all of that. Oh, boy.
So the only way to get any compensation for this claim was to go after the homeowner who was the host and who had insurance to their home.
Sure.
So they're trying to get some compensation for this poor girl.
Right.
Who is rendered a quadriplegic. And so it went to the trial level, went to the Ontario Court of Appeal, and then ultimately to the Supreme Court of Canada, who for the first time in Canada looked at social hosts and said, is there a duty of care here? Do you as a social host owe a duty to motorists out there if someone at your house gets drunk and drives?
Now, before you tell us what the court said, I would think that pretty much everybody listening right now, Bill, will go, well, yes, of course I do. It's my house. It's my booze. Yeah. It's my party. Somebody's going to want to come after me if something bad happens. What did the Supreme Court of Canada say?
Supreme Court of Canada said there was no duty of care.
How about that?
Owed to the motorists.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, and they did. What they did is they contrasted a social host to a commercial host. A commercial host is a tavern or
a bar.
Well,
and that's a whole other story, and we'll get into that in a minute.
But they
back to the house party, though.
Yeah.
So you couldn't compare the host of a house party to a bartender.
Yeah, they said there's really no obligation on a homeowner to monitor how much your partiers, people in your house, drink. It's unrealistic. Unlike a bar, who have an obligation by law to monitor that.
Right.
And they said there's a real difference between a commercial host and a social host in terms of that obligation to monitor.
Mm-hmm.
And they said there wasn't enough connection between, you know, someone who has a positive obligation. Now, whether that they have left open the door, and I should say this.
Well,
we'll get to that.
Okay, because Joe Murphy's just rolling his eyes, sitting right beside you now, going, I'd like to have a crack at that one.
Sure.
Joe, what do you think? Did the Supreme Court, did they left the door open, as Bill just said, but was that a good decision?
Well, good or bad, the reality is the door's left open, and there's so many situations. I think the key fact in that case is that the homeowner didn't know how much he'd had to drink.
Right.
Yeah. Whereas other cases, the homeowner knows and encourages. Oh, you've got to try this.
Sure.
You've got to have another.
How
about one for the road?
Drinking games. It does go on, doesn't it?
You know, a classic situation is you have teenagers, 17, 18. They're at home. The homeowner, their kids say, listen, we think you should learn how to drink before you turn 19, so we're going to let you drink.
In the confines of our home, where you're safe.
In the safety of our home.
That's
right. If they've got a friend or two over, they may say, yeah, they can have a few drinks. And then someone goes out and something bad happens.
Right.
I would think the homeowner would be liable.
For underage drinkers, especially.
Underage drinkers, people
right.
who they not only know how much they've had to drink, but have encouraged them to drink more and more.
And that's exactly what the Supreme Court of Canada said. They left open the question of a scenario where you are contributing ultimately to that person drinking, you're encouraging them to drink, you know how much they've had,
right.
and you know that they're going to get in the car and drive.
Right.
In those circumstances, the court said, we don't have to decide that question, but we're going to leave that open as a possibility to find that duty of care that you need.
Right.
And what Joe said in that scenario where you have a parent and a child, that's different than adults. And the Supreme Court of Canada actually made that clear.
Right.
That's a special relationship that you have an obligation.
And there's trust and responsibility.
You have an obligation and it's a special category to positively act to monitor what they're doing.
Right.
And if you set them out in the world and they're drinking and you know that they might get in a car and drive and hurt someone.
It's on you.
In those circumstances, I think a court would say you owe a duty of care.
I asked you, Mr. Murphy, a bad legal question. I asked you if you thought the Supreme Court of Canada was a bad decision. You rolled your eyes. I don't want to answer that one. So let me ask you it this way. Did the decision surprise you? Did you not expect the court to indicate that there might be some measure of responsibility for the party host in all circumstances?
I would have expected the court on those facts to have found some responsibility, but the key is their finding. And I think this fact was key to their finding that the homeowner didn't know, had no idea how much this fellow had to drink.
Right.
Yeah. I find it unusual, unless you've got a big party, that the homeowner host who's making sure everyone's drink is full.
That's part of the job.
Doesn't know that this fellow's had a dozen beer in 2 hours.
Right.
This was a BYOB party.
So, okay.
So what's interesting is you know, there's been a lot of commentary on the Supreme Court of Canada case.
I'll bet.
The plaintiff's bar, which Joe and I are part of, say it has to be limited to its facts because the homeowner was found not to know how much he had to drink, didn't know he was impaired when he left the house, and those are critical findings of fact. The defense bar says, no, the Supreme Court of Canada went further than that. They said there's no duty of care. But the reality is that because there's that possibility, homeowners should be very, very vigilant.
Exactly.
As far as I'm concerned, in terms of not making sure that your guests don't drink and drive after they leave your house.
And that is precisely the purpose of this episode of The Law Show. We did not invite Bill Grinch and Joe Buzzkill. We invited Bill Dick and Joe Murphy from Murphy Batista LLP, personal injury lawyers, to talk about party time, party season, and who's responsible for what. So once you have a better understanding of all that, you might be able to relax and have some fun. We're back with more right after this.
There's more of the show still ahead. This is The Law Show on CIAL 650.